Good morning and welcome to worship today. Just a couple announcements to highlight. Our Faith in Action Committee will be providing dinner for the homeless in Harrisburg tomorrow. If you're interested in donating or volunteering, Rodney Gross's contact information is found in your bulletin. So I'm returning from confirmation camp. We came back yesterday. There were three of our young people there. I see Elsa's here. And Adam is here, although he got a little sick. He had to come home a little early. And Jordan Paul, who I think is off to another camp already. But they were with me at camp, and you'll hear more about it in the sermon. So tomorrow, the next phase of our construction in the church building begins. As you could have read in the announcements, some of the demolition will begin tomorrow in the basement. And the restroom areas will also be renovating in this time. So for now, they are open and they're available for use, but we're kind of encouraging you to stay away from those areas of the church as this project goes forward, finally. Thank heavens, right? And now I invite you to please rise for confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who looks upon us in compassion, forgives our sin, and heals our lives.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Have mercy, O God.
Against you, you alone, we have sinned.
In your compassion, cleanse us from our sin and take away our guilt. Create in us a new heart and give us a steadfast spirit. Fill us with your Holy Spirit and restore your joy within us. Amen. As tender as parent to child, so deep in God's compassion for you, as high as heaven is above earth, so vast is God's love for you. As far as east is from west, so far God removes your sin from you, renewing your life through Jesus Christ. By the mercy of God, we are united with Christ Jesus, in whom we are forgiven. Amen. Amen.
For I am your God.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion with the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Teach us, good Lord God, to serve you as you deserve, to give and not to count the cost, to fight and not to heal the wounds, to toil and not to seek for rest, to labor and not to ask for a reward, except that of knowing that we do your will. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated.
The first reading is from Jeremiah, the 20th chapter. O Lord, you have enticed me, and I was enticed. You have overpowered me, and you have prevailed. I have become a laughingstock all day long. Everyone mocks me. For whenever I speak, I must cry out. I must shout violence and destruction. For the word of the Lord has become for me a reproach and derision all day long. If I say, I will not mention him or speak any more in his name, then within me there is something like a burning fire shut up in my bones. I am weary with holding it in, and I cannot, for I hear many whispering, terror is all around. Denounce him. Let us denounce him. All my friends are watching for me to stumble. Perhaps he can be enticed and we can prevail against him or take our revenge on him. But the Lord is with me like a dread warrior. Therefore, my persecutors will stumble and they will not prevail. They will be greatly shamed, for they will not succeed. Their eternal dishonor will never be forgotten. O Lord of hosts, you test the righteous. You see the heart and the mind. Let me see your retribution upon them, for to you I have committed my cause. Sing to the Lord, praise the Lord, for he has delivered the life of the needy from the hands of evildoers. We will now read responsively from Psalm 69. Surely for your sake I have suffered reproach, and shame has covered my face. I have become a stranger to my own kindred, an alien to my mother's children. Zeal for your house has eaten me up. The scorn of those who scorn you has fallen upon me.
I humbled myself with fasting, but that was turned to my reproach.
Answer me, O Lord, for your love is kind. In your great compassion, turn to me.
Hide not your face from your servant.
Be swift and answer me, for I am in distress. Draw near to me and redeem me, because of my enemies, deliver me. The second reading is from Romans, the 6th chapter. Should we continue in sin in order that grace may abound? By no means. How can we who died to sin go on living in it? Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Therefore, we have been buried with him by baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so we, too, might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body of sin might be destroyed and we might no longer be enslaved to sin. For whoever has died is freed from sin. But if we have died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. The death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. So you also must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Hallelujah, Lord and Savior, open all your
The Holy Gospel according to Matthew, the 10th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said to the 12, "A disciple is not above the teacher, nor a slave above the master. It is enough for the disciple to be like the teacher and the slave like the master. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebub, how much more will they malign those of his household? So have no fear of them, for nothing is covered up that will not be uncovered, and nothing secret that will not become known. What I say to you in the dark, tell in the light, and what you hear whispered, proclaim from the housetops. Do not fear those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Rather fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. And not two sparrows sold for a penny. Yet not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father. And even the hairs of your head are all counted. So do not be afraid. You are of more value than many sparrows. Everyone, therefore, who acknowledges me before others, I will also acknowledge before my Father in heaven. But whoever denies me before others, I also will deny before my Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to bring peace to the earth. I have not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to set a man against his father, and a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law, and one's foes will be members of one's own household. Whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me, and whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me, and whoever does not take up the cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Those who find their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it." The Gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please pray with me. Let the meditation of our hearts and minds, the words that are spoken, and our hearing of them be acceptable unto you, O God, our Lord, our Rock, and our Redeemer. Amen. So in the service of Holy Baptism, we together, and along with the person who's being baptized, if they can so speak, or parents and sponsors, we reject sin in a series of renunciations. We say, do you renounce the devil and all the forces that defy God? And you say, we do. Do you renounce the powers of this world that rebel against God? And you respond, we do. And do you renounce the ways of sin that draw you from God? And then we say, I renounce them. In today's gospel, Jesus warns the disciples about what sorts of evil and risks and divisions may be ahead of them. These disciples have already learned that discipleship comes with a cost. They gave up a great deal and have been challenging the status quo, including Roman authority, and in that day, that very challenge could cost them their lives. Today, risks of living out our faith, especially in countries without freedom of religion, still exist, but most of us, I think, have difficulty imagining what resistance to our faith would look like, especially resistance that will cause us to lose our lives. One look at the morning news, though, does remind us of the presence of evil in our world and in our lives. We resist evil when we raise our voices against violence, when we march against inequality, when we welcome and give aid to the stranger in need, and when we fight for the rights of those who are underprivileged or suffering or less fortunate, or suffering from any prejudice of any kind. Our passage from Matthew certainly is a difficult one and disturbing on that level. There is gospel to be found in it. Jesus tells those who follow him not to fear, and that we are called to follow Jesus with dependence on a most gracious God, caring for all the hairs of our heads and caring for us more than any number of sparrows. Matthew 10:27 reminds us that we are called to proclaim the gospel in light and from the housetops, fighting against darkness and evil. The gospel and God's message of love and forgiveness filled with grace really is the most powerful tool we have against the evil of this world. So as I mentioned earlier, yesterday, late afternoon, I returned home from this week of camp we call Harrisburg Area Confirmation Camp. It was like the 53rd year of that camp. Years ago, a group of pastors in Harrisburg got together and began the camp. And ever since, youth have been gathering for this camp in this week of July. And as I mentioned, Adam Gardner and Elsa Nielsen and Jordan Paul were with me at camp. I've been going since 1992, pretty long time. It's been an important part of my faith journey. And really, I'm not sure I'd be here if I hadn't gone to this camp at one point in my life. The most important thing about the experience is that we try to create this community of love, a community of love where we can consider our faith and live it out in a good and visible way by loving each other. And we do that really by going away, by going off to retreat and kind of remove ourselves from our everyday lives filled with all those temptations and those evils that we find around us. Now, don't get me wrong, evil still exists at camp. It's still there. But in this community, we try to create an atmosphere where our young people will learn that they can rely on God and each other and their leaders and those, their parents and people who love them to sustain their faith and give them strength. This year we had about 180 youth and leaders, and the whole focus of the week is to consider what it means to live as a baptized child of God. So I just always have to reflect on it with you every year when I get back, so give me some leeway a little bit, but I think that really what I'm talking about really does respond to the evil talked about in our gospel lesson today. So Monday's learning is centered on the theme of forgiveness, and we talk about God's gracious and unconditional forgiveness, and really that forgiveness frees us to become people that God desires us to be in this world, truly and wholeheartedly, not worrying about the impact of sin and even death, because Jesus sets us free to love in a peace-filled way, loving way, because we know we are loved and forgiven. Then on Tuesday, we talk about the theme of created for community and what it means to live in community. You know what it's like with the body of Christ. We need all of you and your many gifts and talents to make the body whole and complete. And that we're gifted, each one of us, and we have unique gifts that, when brought together, create a good community. On Wednesday, our theme is servanthood, and we talk about Christ's supreme example of servanthood. A lot of the tracks that day we meet for worship only in our small group, our small grade level tracks, and most of them wash feet too, as a visible example of what that servanthood can look like. Our theme on Thursday is reconciliation, and we gather for a service of absolution and forgiveness. We have communion every day at camp. That is like the core of our time together. And so that study helps us understand the importance of forgiveness in our lives. And we all know what that means. I mean, it's important to know we are forgiven, first of all, no matter what we've done. But also important for our well-being to try to forgive those who have hurt us, not to necessarily condone any sin that has perpetrated against us, but to learn how to forgive someone, even if they don't want it. So then on Friday, our theme is sainthood. You know, Luther firmly believed that we are simultaneously that saint and sinner, claimed in our baptism as God's beloved child, but also living in a world that will pull us away from the covenant that God makes with us to be with us. But that covenant never ends, and we are never alone. So that's the important part of Friday, but also there's a lot of emphasis on light that day, that we live in this darkness of evil, but that we are called to offer God's light to the world. So each day ends with a presentation of what we call images. It's filled with pictures and voices of the events of the day and reflections from various leaders and youth about the theme. And it just so happens that our Elsa, on Friday night, was asked to give a reflection on the light of Christ and what it meant for her. And she doesn't know I'm going to share her reflection, but I am. Because Elsa, you wrote my sermon for me, so thank you. So here it is. Remember, whenever you are feeling alone or like the world is against you or like nobody has your back, you are not alone. Seek the light of Christ in word, song, and prayer. Seek the light by spending time with your friends and your family and your youth group and those you trust. Shine the light into the darkness. Even the smallest flame can light up the world. Do not be overcome by the darkness. There are people out there who love you and who want to help you, who will help us, and Jesus is one of those people. Personally, Elsa's personally, I find peace by praying, by being with my friends, by being here at Nauwakwa. Camp has helped me get closer to God, has helped me find my light. In Matthew, in the Sermon on the Mountain, Jesus tells us to let our light shine like a city on the hill, which are words we also heard in our gospel today. Don't underestimate how far your light can shine. Just think, a single gesture of kindness can change the course of someone's day. Saying the words, I love you, I will always be there for you, and I am here to listen, can change someone's life forever. We are called to be that light. We are here to learn to be that light. So those were Elsa's words for camp, but I think that's what we are all learning each and every day. How can we be that light? Elsa said those words much better than anything I could have ever said, and that's why I stole them from her. So God's light helps us as we all face darkness and evil in life. And may we always have the courage and wisdom, Elsa, like the wisdom Elsa gave us to share that light. Amen. Please be seated. Trusting in God's abundant mercy, let us offer our prayers for a world in need. You entice your church, O God, to speak truth that challenges false notions of peace. Prevail upon us with the good news of Christ's death and resurrection, that we are compelled to share the gospel with all the world. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Under your watch, not even a sparrow goes unnoticed. Safeguard plant and animal habitats threatened by melting glaciers, rising oceans, and receding coastlines. Amplify the voices of those calling for responsible stewardship of the earth's resources. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Our world is enduring violence and destruction. Rescue your people and nations experiencing conflict or crisis. Thwart the efforts of those who sow chaos and terror, and guide those working to bring about peace and reconciliation. Comfort those suffering due to war, conflict, or injustice. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Holy God, you have counted even the hairs of our heads. Reassure anyone in need of your healing presence that every life has value. Look favorably upon all who struggle. We especially pray today for Jim Baumberger, Dennis Buchanan, Kelly Diodario, Donna Dixon, Jerry Fickling, Wally Folkrod, Janice Geiling, Glenn Hoffa, Diane Hollebeck, Dean Hebner, Mary Hebner, Joe Lewin, Laura McEwen, Nancy Miller, Chip Murray, Donna Pastuck, Tom Rieger, Val Rowe, Ed Schaefer, Bob Seibert, Beverly Spinagle, Irene Terzai, Jackie Walters, Bob Warden, Mike Welty, and all those we either name before you in our hearts or aloud. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Even when we experience rejection, your love invites us to new life. Lift up anyone who feels shunned or excluded on account of any reason, gender, race, sexual orientation, gender identity, national origin, or any other human distinction. Make your people one, O God. We pray in your mercy. Hear our prayer. All who have died with Christ also live with him. We give thanks for all the saints whose faithful confession inspired our own discipleship and raise us up with them to eternal life, God, and give hope to all who mourn. Today, we pray especially for the family of Lloyd Clegg. This is the brother-in-law of Sharon Murray. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Receive our prayers and answer us, O God, in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us share a sign of God's peace with one another.
Let us pray. God of field and forest, sea and sky, you are the giver of all good things. Sustain us with these gifts of your creation and multiply your graciousness in us, that the world may be fed with your love through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We give thanks to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Thanks be to God. body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray. We thank you, generous God, for the refreshment we have received at your banquet table. Send us now to spread your generosity into all the world through the one who is our dearest treasure, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
The God who calls across the cosmos and speaks in the smallest seed, bless, keep, and sustain you now and until the end of the age. Amen.
Amen.
Go in peace, share the harvest.
Thanks be to God.